It's 6:30, so I'd like to call the meeting to order. Excuse me. 6:30, and I'd like to call the meeting to order, please. Thank you very much. I would appreciate it if you would all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. May I have roll call, please?
Mr. Pantera.
Here.
Mrs. Case.
Here.
Mrs. Greenberg.
Here.
Mrs. Baker.
Here.
Mrs. Christensen.
Here.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is approval of agenda. Dr. Bales.
Thank you, President Greenberg. Items approved by consent will not come up for discussion during the meeting, but will be approved when the agenda is adopted. This is possible since members of the governing board receive the agenda along with backup materials at least 24 hours prior to the meeting and have had time to review and consider all items. Prior to the agenda being adopted, members of the governing board may ask that an item be removed from the consent agenda and brought to the floor for discussion at the appropriate place on the agenda. Any member of the audience who submitted a blue public comment card prior to the start of the meeting will be recognized to speak on that agenda item under items for approval. I would like to offer the agenda as posted with the following exception. I'd like to remove from consent agenda item F8 and move that to items for approval that will come on the agenda after gifts and donations. And also just one technical clarification on items F12, governing board members. It refers, there's a typo, it says refers to PV contract 18-15 PV, it's 23-15. So that one clerk, or otherwise with the exception of F8, I recommend the agenda as posted.
I got a question, Dr. Bill. What'd you say about 12 again?
Number 12, consideration approve purchase from current PV contract. It says 18-15 PV. It should say 23-15.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bales. So, excuse me, prior to the meeting, we received one blue comment card. So that speaker will have 3 minutes to speak on the specific agenda item. That's the one that was moved from the consent agenda. As a reminder, we ask that you please direct your comments to the board. Does any member of the governing board wish to remove anything from the consent agenda and move it to the approval agenda? Seeing none, Mr. Pantera may have a motion to approve the meeting agenda and recommend a consent agenda items as presented.
So moved.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed, please say nay. Any abstentions? Motion passes unanimously. Next on the agenda is governing board statements. I'll start to my left, Mrs. Baker.
Thank you, President Greenberg. Welcome everyone tonight. It's nice to see so many faces out there. I'm gonna be brief. I just wanna say that tonight I'm feeling really grateful. I have 3 kids at 3 different schools with 3 very different set of educational needs. And the educators in this district, I feel, have just gone above and beyond for my kids lately. And if my kids are getting that kind of care, I know other kids are getting that kind of care. And I just wanna thank our teachers and our ESPs and everyone who just makes this all possible. So thank you very much. And that's it.
Thank you, Mrs. Baker. Mrs. Christensen.
Good evening, everyone. I would just like to thank everybody who made the time to come to the board meeting today, because we decide very important things for the community, and we, as elected officials, we represent you all. So thank you for being here. And I want to echo Mrs. Baker's comments that we do have some amazing teachers here that are so warm and compassionate and really go over and above for our children. My kid's a senior this year, and I can just think of dozens that have really made a big impact in his life and his life path going forward. So thank you all for being here. And I did want to shout out, Dr. Bales is probably going to say something about this later, but the CTE month? Yeah, so shout out to all of those career and technical education educators and students, because this is a very important part of our education process, not just to prepare children for college, but beyond if they decide they want alternative work options.
Thank you, Mrs. Christensen. Mr. Pantera.
Well, thank you, President Greenberg. Hello, everyone. Welcome. I'm glad you're here participating in the most intimate and direct government interface there is, you and your school board, your elected school board. Thank you for being here tonight. I'm just thinking about what we did this last week. My wife and I, we did the spring cleaning thing. I don't know if you do that spring cleaning at home, but we're so glad that I was able to take all our clothing or other things that we use to Campobello Elementary School. They have the Eagle's Nest, their own thrift store. It's a great thing to do. Maybe you're doing any kind of spring cleaning or that sort of thing this time of year. Please look to your local schools, see what they might need. Maybe they don't have a thrift store, but nurses always need some clothes for these kids sometimes, right? Emergencies. Art teachers always need something. Paris Valley Education Association has their prom boutique coming up. They always need formal dresses and suits and other accessories for their to help students go to prom who maybe can't afford it completely. So when you're doing your preparations before spring break or spring cleaning, look to your schools to help them out. I know you will, because that's the kind of people we have here. And that concludes my statement.
Thank you, Mr. Pantera. Mrs. Case.
Thank you. Good evening. Welcome, everyone. Last board meeting, I spoke about CTE, and I just want to shout out again for the many programs we have in our district. I have a lot of young people who are students in our district who do various jobs. I used to have children do it, and I didn't pay them. Now I have other people's children, and I pay them. And I think, oh, well, anyway. So I get to talk to a lot of our students, and it's really interesting, the conversation I have with these young men and young women and elementary school kids that I see other places. And we're doing some fabulous things, and I'm so excited, and I'm hoping that we expand some of our CTE programs to even reach greater areas. We have an opportunity to change our area, our state, and go into the nation with the things that we have available for our students. And I'm really excited, and I'm grateful that Dr. Bells is doing a presentation on that. And I was looking at the HOSA PV High School Bioscience, and there are so many opportunities. You can have really brainy classes, you can have hands-on, you can have a variety. And I have grandchildren who fit all kinds of categories, and I know how important it is to have a variety of classes that we offer. And I'm just grateful for the foresight that this district has had for years to offer a variety of things. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Case. I'd like to join my fellow board members in welcoming everybody here. It's a great crowd. There were a few things said that I was going to say, but I also want to note that with the PVA prom boutique, if you don't have anything in your closets to donate, thank you. They do have a wish list at Amazon for some items that you would not want to wear used, and some other pieces. And it goes beyond. So if you have gift cards, so students can, you know, go out to dinner before the prom, et cetera, et cetera. There's a whole wealth of things that you can provide if you are so inclined. And I'm also looking forward to the CTE month presentation. I have always appreciated how PVUSD has brought CTE to the forefront and supported and expanded the programs. When we joined WESMEC, that was, just a marvelous way to demonstrate to our students the support that, we support the part of when we talk about college and career ready, that we support career as well as college. And I'm also looking forward to the next thing on the agenda, where we are going to be recognizing our National Board Certified Teachers And although we'll get to thank you in, you know, individually, this is an amazing program. This is teachers who become nationally board certified. I'm sure we're going to have a little bit better explanation when we get to it, but it's a very rigorous process, and to be so recognized and have so many in our district who not just aspire but attain this recognition is incredible. So I want to thank our teachers for going above and beyond yet again in this area in particular. So those are my comments, and next is awards and recognitions. Dr.
Thank you, President Greenberg. It's always a pleasure to highlight students and staff, and tonight we have that opportunity to really celebrate some staff awards. And Mr. Droege will MC our honors tonight, so at this time I'd like to invite the governing board down to join me in front of the dais.
Good evening, President Greenberg, Governing Board members, Dr. Bales, members of Cabinet, and attendees both in person and virtual. Tonight we have a very impressive recognition to share with you. This evening we'll be inviting our honorees to the front of the room for a group recognition and photo. So when I say your name, please come to the front of the room. Tonight we'd like to honor 9 individuals who have maintained or newly achieved their National Board Certified Teacher status. NBCT is considered the pinnacle of recognition in education and represents an educator's diligence, dedication, and skill. This incredible accomplishment is not just a personal milestone for these teachers, but also a driving force for ongoing improvement in PV schools. Please put your hands together for the newly achieved category from Palomino Intermediate, Nancy Franke. From Pinnacle High School, Christina Bonifaci Hughes. From Pinnacle High School, Antonella Ferreira. From Pinnacle High School, Suzanne Hunt. From Pinnacle Peak Preparatory, Aubrey Singer. Maintaining their National Board Certified Teacher status from Campobello Elementary School, Jennifer Juhas. From Palomino Primary, Angela Morgan. From the District Gifted Department, Elizabeth Warner. And unable to be here this evening from the District Professional Development Department, Jennifer Hudson. And that, President Greenberg, concludes this evening's awards and recognitions.
Thank you all, and congratulations again. And next on our agenda is superintendent comments. Dr. Bales.
Thank you very much, President Greenberg, governing board members, cabinet, and guests. It's really an honor to return tonight to talk and celebrate our teachers. It was nearly 30 years ago. I remember working in another district when I actually was reading about Paradise Valley and how they had awarded their first teacher in the state of Arizona as nationally board recognized Kathy Webke. And it was a very proud moment. And working in another district said, I want to work in that district. That's a leader. And I had recommended that the district I was in consider that. I was in the HR office at that time, and they had passed on it. And I thought, you're missing the boat. This is it. And it's still today a very nice honor. So congratulations to all of our teachers who have earned that recognition. I also just want to say that when the agenda was adopted, several summer renovation projects were approved, and I'd like to extend my thanks to the voters who passed our bond election, allowing us the opportunity to refresh, replace, and maintain properties, giving our students safe and clean environments for learning and extracurricular activities. So thank you so much to our voters. In PV Schools, we engage, inspire, and nurture relationships and students through high-quality instruction, meaningful educational opportunities, and dynamic learning experiences. One of those experiences is our CTE program that we just have heard others talk about, and we're going to get to that in a little bit here, which are a very integral part to the growth and career development of so many students. And on March 21st, PV Schools CTE will sponsor the Women in STEAM Career Talks. This virtual panel session allows all 7th through 12th grade students to hear from female industry experts who work in the fields of science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. These women will share their journey and talk about the life-changing opportunities students can find in STEM and STEAM careers. And for more information on this event, check out episode 25 of PV Beat, the district podcast. It's available on Apple and Spotify, and all that information is online for this really wonderful opportunity. Next, Sights and Sounds is right around the corner. Join PV Schools in celebrating the artistic, creative, and musical talents of our students and staff by attending the 14th annual Sights and Sounds of PV Schools. This awe-inspiring event will be held on Saturday, March 2nd, from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. at Shadow Mountain High School. The exhibit will include band, choir, orchestra, dance, and theater performances, as well as student artwork. This is a wonderful opportunity to gather in one location to see and hear the incredible work that our K-12 students are producing. This is an unforgettable and moving experience for all, and we look forward to seeing you there on that date, March 2nd. Come at whatever time fits your schedule. It's great. Next is Donuts with the District. That's right, check out Donuts with the District. This is an opportunity for parents, guardians, and community members to meet with me and cabinet members, as well as a few board members, and in an informal setting throughout the district. This casual meet and greet setting offers the community a chance to hear from district leadership, as well as provide feedback on timely educational topics. This event, supporting the PV School's strategic plan, promotes community strength and collaboration within the district. Our next event is scheduled for February 29th from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. at Cactus View Elementary. And of course, Spanish interpretation will also be available. We heard some nice comments and compliments about our teachers, and next week is National Public Schools Week. Join PV Schools from February 26th to March 1st to celebrate all the amazing things that happen each and every day across our district. This week celebrates the teachers, staff, students, and parents who have chosen public education. Positive things happen in public school classrooms each day because of the caring professionals committed to serving all students. Public education prepares students to succeed in a diverse and ever-changing world. We know families have a choice, and we're grateful to every family who has made PV Schools their first pick for education. And lastly, as mentioned earlier, CTE month, that's what we're in. As you know, February is that month we celebrate CTE programs here in the district and nationally. And we want to celebrate all the fantastic career and technical education teachers, students, and programs. PV Schools offers over 20 individual programs throughout our 5 excelling high schools. Our district prides itself on providing students with a head start on a path towards some of the fastest growing careers in the country. Career and technical education brings top industries into the classroom. And while we've highlighted many of these opportunities on our podcast this month, tonight I'd like to turn things over to Dr. Corson, who will continue this celebration with a short presentation.
Good Good evening, President Greenberg, members of the Governing Board, Dr. Bales, Cabinet, and guests. As we celebrate CTE Month, it is a prime opportunity to showcase the profound impact CTE programs have on our students' futures. CTE equips our students with practical skills, fosters innovation, and prepares them for the dynamic demands of the modern workforce. CTE plays a pivotal role in the success of PV School's educational mission, and I'm honored to introduce our Director of CTE this evening, Melissa Malzahn.
I go back. Oh, there we go. Perfect. All right. Thank you, Dr. Corson. Good evening, President Greenberg, Governing Board, Dr. Bales, Cabinet, and guests. Thank you so much for inviting us to present for CTE Month so we can highlight some of the amazing benefits students receive through career and technical education. This evening, Bioscience HOSA President Krish Desai and Skills USA Officer Jane DeWang Cagno will highlight the many opportunities provided by their respective CTSOs. HOSA and Skills USA are two of the five career and technical student organizations that we have throughout our district. Each of our 21 CTE programs align with one of the designated CTSOs that provide student opportunities to develop and enhance leadership skills. Please welcome Krish Desai and Jane DeWang Cagno.
Good afternoon, Governing Board, Superintendent Bales, Cabinet members, and guests. We're here today to celebrate Career and Technical Education Month, as well as Career and Technical Student Organizations. My name is Krish Desai, and I'm the president of Paradise Valley Crest's Bioscience HOSA chapter. Today, we'll be presenting a brief presentation on our chapter and its accomplishments. Go to the next slide. So first, our team. Our executive board consists of 11 officers that each have a unique and important role. Our officers are selected through an extensive slating process, and our chapter actually has two students who currently serve as Arizona HOSA State Officers, the Secretary and the Historian Reporter. Additionally, our chapter advisors are the wonderful Ms. Cherry and Mrs. Launderville. The main goal of our chapter is to help provide our members with the necessary skills to ensure that they are successful as future healthcare professionals. And this is through a multitude and variety of opportunities and activities, some of which are located up here on the slide. Additionally, the international current theme for HOSA is Dare to Create, and the state theme is Create Your Story. Our chapter attends three major leadership conferences throughout the school year. The first is Fall Leadership Conference, or FLC, which is a one-day event where members attend different workshops relating to networking, careers, leadership, and professionals, where they get to meet and learn from different healthcare professionals, as well as different HOSA members from across the state. Competitions then take us to the next two leadership conferences, the State and the International Leadership Conference. HOSA offers over 60 competitive events to our members, and these test a broad range of practical, hands-on skills, as well as knowledge. SLC and ILC allow our members to further network and connect with like-minded individuals from across the globe, but also get recognized in their hard work and effort. Last year, our chapter took over 20 students to the International Leadership Conference, and this year we plan to take 70 students to our state conference. Finally, our chapter prides itself on volunteering and fundraising. And we, last year, for example, we held a very successful fundraiser about student hygiene and toiletry drive where we were able to collect these items for students at Paradise Valley High School. And we also, this helped serve as a great opportunity for our members where they could see the local impact on their own community. And we also fundraise for NMDP, which is the premier service project for HOSA.
Good evening, I am Janduin Cagno, and I'm the current president of Paradise Valley Crest Skills USA chapter and of Skills USA Arizona Region 2. With Krish, I'm here to celebrate career technical education through the accomplishments of my CTSO. The Skills USA Crest Executive Board is led by 11 Crest students from all three strands, with some of our board serving as officers for Region 2 of Skills USA Arizona. Lastly, our organization would not be possible without our amazing chapter advisors, Ms. Verma, Dr. Samuel, Mr. Troxel, and Mrs. Seton. Our Skills USA chapter engages our members in various opportunities, such as leadership and technical workshops, guest speakers and industry leaders, hands-on projects, and professional development. Our chapter and our events are based upon the 17 essential elements of the Skills USA framework. We aim to provide our members with an improvement with their personal, technical, and workplace skills while simultaneously intertwining our annual theme within our events, which for this year is No Limits. Our members also have the opportunity of attending two leadership events through Skills USA: the Fall Leadership Conference at the Phoenix Convention Center, where students attend different workshops and engage in networking with industry professionals and fellow leaders, and then CAB Champion in Williams, Arizona, where students engage in various leadership activities. Through these events, members are able to develop their professional and collaborative skills necessary to succeed in the workplace. And lastly, our students have the opportunity of being recognized both locally and nationally through competitions, with leadership events from extemporaneous speaking to quiz bowl, and technical events from web design to architectural drafting. Members have over 100 different competitions to choose from to compete in across regional, state, and national leadership and skills conferences. And this past year, we had over 15 students win gold in their respective events at state and qualify for nationals in Atlanta. And pictured above are those members who were able to attend state and nationals this past year. And with over 100 members this year, we aim to continue our chapter success and the success of our members. And we would like to thank everyone, especially the PVUSD Governing Board and Mrs. Mulzon, for continuing to support CTE across our districts as we develop our leadership and technical skills.
And thank you so much for letting us present tonight.
That's a hard act to follow. And thank you, gentlemen, for presenting. Thank you to our CTE educators and leaders. Dr. Corson, thank you. That concludes my comments tonight.
Thank you very much. And let me echo the thanks for our dynamic presenters. That was amazing. So next on the agenda are items for approval. First is, G1, acceptance of the 2023 audit reports issued for the 2022-23 fiscal year. Dr. Bales.
Thank you, President Greenberg, Governing Board members, Cabinet, and guests tonight. We do present for approval the fiscal 22-23 audit reports. This is an opportunity to accept those. And with a brief presentation, Ms. Berrigan, through the magic of audio connectivity, is going to lead us through her presentation. And we'll pull up that slideshow now, and I will advance as necessary.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Bales, President Greenberg, and Governing Board. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay. Go ahead and advance one, and then one more. Okay, so the objective for the evening is to review the purpose, scope, and the results of the annual financial audit. And the agenda on the next slide, please, is the requirements of the audit, the process we undergo, the reports that are provided at the end, and the results of those reports. So next slide, starting with the audit requirements in Arizona Revised Statute 15914. We have a requirement for school districts who have a M&O budget above $2 million, which we certainly do, to have an annual financial statement audit, as well as a completion of the USFR, which is the Uniform System of Financial Records, a compliance questionnaire with 170 questions. Also, districts who spend more than $750,000 in federal revenues, which we also do, undergo a federal single audit. And then just as a reminder, in the spring of 2021, the legislature passed a bill that requires the boards to publicly accept these audits through a roll call vote. So Ms. Chisman will take you all through a roll call vote at the end of the presentation. And then we upload these files to the Arizona Department of Education and provide them to the county school superintendent's office as well. And on the next slide, we have the audit process. It is a bit of a process. We start with our contract procurement, which we have in fiscal year 23 been in our second year of that contract for this most recent audit with our external auditors, Heinfeld and Meech. And then each year we send our financial data to the auditors so they can start to look through that and determine which field work pieces they'd like to review. And then they send those requests to us at the district. Our staff prepare that documentation, and some of that is hard copy and some of that is electronic. And we pull all of that together so that it's ready for the auditors when they come out for their field work in the summer. And they go through all of that and ask us many, many questions. And after several days, they put it all together and they go back to their offices, and they come back after we've closed the year in October or November timeframe and do the second part of their audit, where that process sort of repeats all over again with additional information. On the next slide, we have the reports that are issued. The first is the communication to governance. Then is the comprehensive annual financial report, which is the big report that you all have a copy of, although it is a little bit smaller this year than it was in previous years. They were able to condense down some of the pages. And so we're at about 135 pages instead of about 170. Then there's also the single audit reporting package, as mentioned, that we do for our federal piece of this, and then the Uniform System of Financial Records Compliance Questionnaire. On the next slide, we'll start with the description of the communication to the governance letter. In that, there were no difficulties encountered in performing the audit, which we want to hear. There were no disagreements. There were no disagreements with management, which we also want to hear. Management has provided all of the required representations, and Heinfeld and Meech, the auditors, complied with their independence requirements. All of that are the pieces that we want to hear on that, and that's all good news. On the next slide, we have the annual comprehensive financial report piece, and we received an unmodified, or what people often refer to in layman's terms as a clean opinion, which is the highest opinion you can get on an independent auditor's report. And there are various sections in the comprehensive financial report. Those main headers for those sections are those that are listed there. On the next slide, we have the single audit reporting package. Again, that's the federal compliance piece that we're required to do. On the next slide, single audit. There we go. That report is on the internal control over our reporting and compliance, and it's performed in accordance with government auditing standards. And here we had no significant deficiencies or material weaknesses identified. Additionally, there's the report on compliance for each major federal program, also required by the uniform guidance. And in that, they have stated, in our opinion, Paradise Valley Unified School District number 69 complied in all material respects with the compliance requirements referred to above that could have a direct and material effect on each of its major federal programs for our fiscal year ended June 30th, 2023. Excuse me. On our next slide, we have the Uniform System of Financial Records Compliance Questionnaires, and there's always a couple of findings in this area, or a little bit more, a few findings in this area. And that is to comply with state statutes that are applicable to Arizona school districts. I need to mute for a second. I am so sorry. The areas reviewed are included, but not limited to those that are listed in that final bullet on this slide. And if we move to the next slide, these were the five areas where we had a compliance questionnaire finding. The first column lists the area. The next column lists that language, and I know it's small, but it is, you guys have this information in detail. What the auditor's comments were, as well as our notes. And then probably most importantly, from my perspective, is the district remedy. What do we do moving forward so we don't encounter this in the future? So in that uniform system, sorry, go ahead and go to the next slide. In the uniform system of financial records compliance questionnaire, we had those five minor non-compliance items that were noted. The average number of findings in our state for school districts are 18 to 20, with 170 questions puts most districts at around an 89%. So for PVUSD, we're at 97% of USFR compliance questions answered with a yes. So that's great news for us. In terms of the audit results, our reports for each were issued on time and able for us to receive the ASBO International and Government Finance Officers submission deadlines for the 31st, as well as for continuing bond disclosures, which had a deadline of February 1st. Also, all of our reports have been issued to our oversight agencies before the requirement of March 31st, 2024. That includes the Arizona Auditor General, the County School Superintendent, and the Federal Clearinghouse. You know, all of these pieces are important because it shows a reflection of the transparency that we have in school districts. And while we have requirements for submissions to these agencies, the reason for those requirements is because we are a public entity and we should be completely open and transparent with all of our information, and we are. So in addition to that, on slide 15, you see this is just a screenshot of our budget and finance page on our website, which is available at pvschools.net. You click on departments, then budget and finance, and you can see our budgets, our annual comprehensive financial reports, just our annual financial reports as well. A lot of reporting on here and a good place for people to look if they have questions. I would just end by saying thank you to some very important people, starting with Vanessa Shapiro. She has moved on from our district and is now in a comparable position to mine in another school district in the Valley. So we're very proud of her for that. But she still played a very important role up through September with our district and helping us through the audit. Kathy DiStefano, who has stepped in as interim while we find a replacement for Ms. Shapiro. Eva Kayas, our director of purchasing, Rob Dethridge, who helps with all of our ADM pieces, the average daily membership, our entire finance department led by incredible supervisors, our purchasing department, our technology department has a piece of the audit, human resources has a piece of the audit, and then they even do visit our school sites for our fixed assets and for some ADM and student record reporting. So just appreciate everybody's cooperation in all of those pieces. And with that, I will try to answer any questions you have. I'm going to take a sip of water.
Thank you, Ms. Berrigan. We know you're struggling. We appreciate you coming in electronically with us this evening. Do we have any questions, President Greenberg?
Well, let me ask for a motion and then we can get to discussion. So, Mr. Mantera, may I have a motion to approve the acceptance of the fiscal year 2022-23 audit reports as presented?
So moved.
So does any member of the board have any questions or comments? Mrs. Case?
Thank you so much for this amazing effort that you put in to inform us of the finances in the district. It's really quite amazing how much information we are given on finances. So thank you. And I just want to make a comment. From my understanding, is this true, Mrs. Berrigan? Do charter schools have to go through what district schools have to?
Charter schools do have annual audits that they go through. Their reporting is a little different. They don't have quite as many requirements as we do. It isn't quite as comprehensive, but they are considered a public entity and do have some requirements that they have to follow.
Okay, how about the private schools getting public money? Do they have to do reports?
No.
Okay. I just know that we go through so many, many hoops to do all of these things, and we're very transparent in the way that we spend money, and I appreciate that so much. So thank you for all your effort.
Most welcome.
Does anybody else have any questions or comments? I would just like to echo my thanks, Ms. Berrigan. Oh, Ms. Christensen. What? She has something. Okay, Ms. Christensen.
I did have some questions in not on the audit, but in terms of the annual comprehensive financial report. On page 131 of that report, I was just looking at trends. I know it's a lot of detail.
Mrs. Christensen, I'm not sure this is, I mean, we're voting on the audit report, not the comprehensive.
Not yet. Okay. Okay.
I'm not totally sure it's agenda.
I thought I saw it on the, it's in the documents. It had both the audit and the.
I mean, but the agenda is acceptance of the audit report, so. Perhaps you can ask Mrs. Berrigan that question separately.
That's fine.
Do you have any questions on the audit report?
Not on the audit.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Pantera?
Well, it's been moved already, so now we're voting.
This is any questions or comments?
Oh, no, I don't. I was going to ask, but Mrs. Case asked the question I was going to ask.
Okay. Does anybody else have any other questions or comments specific to the agenda item? Seeing none, just Ms. Berrigan, want to thank you again and thank the staff for when we talk about comprehensive, this is comprehensive, and appreciate all the work that you all do. And the efforts are obviously recognized with the fact that we came through with shining colors in just about every area. No one else has any questions or comments. May I have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Pantera?
Aye.
Mrs. Case?
Aye.
Mrs. Greenberg?
Aye.
Mrs. Baker?
Aye.
Mrs. Christensen?
Aye.
Since there are no nays or abstentions, the motion passes unanimously. Thank you again, Mrs. Berrigan. Next on the agenda is acceptance of gifts and donations. So I'd like to review just a few that we received, and we received many, but would like to highlight Dorito Partners, Inc. Provided Echo Mountain Intermediate with $1,000 for their Caught Being Kind School. Thunderbirds Foundation gave $1,000 to Horizon High School for girls golf, and the PV High School PTO Booster Club gave just under $5,800 to the Trek program. So once again, there are many, many other donors. If anybody is here, please accept our thanks. If you know of anyone, please extend our thanks. And Mr. Pantera may have a motion for acceptance of gifts and donations, please.
So moved.
Does anybody wish to make a comment or have a question? Seeing none, all those members in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Say nay. Any abstentions? Motion passes unanimously. We did have one item moved from the consent agenda, and just trying to get this back up. That was item F8, which is consideration and approval of business operations administrative ESP employee travel requests. So Dr. Bales, if you could give us a little bit of information on that.
Sure, President Greenberg, thank you. Governing board members, cabinet and guests, and tonight we present for approval business operations administrative ESP travel. The Arizona School of Business Officials provides professional development opportunities on the operational side of school districts, including finance, payroll, procurement, facilities, construction, transportation, nutrition, and wellness, accounting, human resources, and information technologies. And these are areas that have over 400 employees throughout the district. These areas have professional development, and this is an opportunity to send those, and this is usually the only annual opportunity to provide some professional development for some of our employees in their respective areas. And although this conference is out of state, it's just over the border in Nevada. And a lot of times the conferences are chosen for these locations because of the inexpensive destination. And we do present as a recommended approval as presented.
Thank you, Dr. Bales. We have one public comment card, Jennifer Ariza. You'll have 3 minutes.
Uh,
Hi, my name is Jennifer Ariza, and I stand here tonight as a concerned parent in the Paradise Valley School District, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak. I am concerned that the board is continuing to act in a manner of business as usual in light of the fact that you voted to close schools in our district this year. My question to the board is, are you going to keep doing the same things over and over again and expect a different result? Because that's the definition of insanity. I will keep challenging the board with this following question. What are you going to start doing differently to help operate our schools at lower costs per student? If you are serious about helping lower costs in PV, I encourage you to vote no on this agenda item. This agenda item, the consideration and approval of business operations administrative ESP employee travel request, is to send administrative team members to attend the Arizona Association of School Business Officials Conference. On the surface, this may seem nominal, but every expense should be scrutinized. Also, it's strange to me that this is an Arizona organization and they've chosen to have a conference in Laughlin, Nevada at the Aquarius Casino Resort. Please help us understand how we can continue to approve these types of expenditures when all we hear about is a budget shortfall. Why would any of our community members think that if we gave you more money, that you would do a better job when you continue to operate as business as usual? That is poor logic. It's time to start raising the bar here in PV and to be innovative with how we manage our budget going forward. Let's take some insight from our competition on how they are operating at lower costs per student. Let's start helping our schools be the school of choice and recruit students. Do you know that Hidden Hills Elementary, who was on the chopping block this year to be closed, is working feverishly to get students back and recruit students in their community? My question to the board is, what are you doing to help them? Are you allocating any budget dollars? I don't see anything on the agenda tonight to do that. I challenge you to not continue to rubber stamp all of the expenditures that you review at these school board meetings, but instead start working to lower and eliminate expenses that are not allowing our schools to operate at lower costs, like our competition. Please work together with our communities to make PV schools the school choice for our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pantera. May I have a motion to approve item FG, consideration, or consideration approval of business operations administrative ESP employee travel request.
So moved.
Does any member have any questions or comments?
I have a question.
Yes.
Basically, this is so that our people we're sending here can deal with the budget here and the operations of our district in a more efficient and cost-effective manner. Is that part of what they do when they go to these, right? The training and the expertise exchanged?
Right, right. So as a conference that hosts many people, and I don't know the attendance for this, but it's business officials from all departments. We have four different departments represented with 12 people, and this is the only really PD opportunity they have in the year to get up to date on legislation that has been passed, explanations, whether that be in transportation or construction or some purchasing and finance. So those several departments that are represented by those that are traveling to this conference this year. There are no M&O costs. These are indirect costs that fund this travel.
Thank you.
Mrs. Christensen?
I had a question on the indirect cost funding source. I tried to look up in the chart of accounts, and it says that it's monies transferred from, it could be from federal projects or food service fund. Is that the case in this, or what exactly is the indirect cost?
Ms. Berrigan?
Yes. Yep. President Greenberg, Mrs. Christensen, indirect costs are what we are allowed to charge when we have grant programs in the district that we oversee for our departments, such as purchasing, finance, facilities, transportation, so that we can obtain some administrative costs for administering those grants. And so this is the one intended purpose for use of the indirect cost fund.
And so because it's not, because it's funding source from grants, it's not, as Dr. Bales indicated, it's not from maintenance and operation. We're getting a grant from, I'm assuming, either federal or state.
It's not MNO. It is it's its own separate fund, Fund 570. And so from each grant, they have different amounts that you can charge for indirect costs, usually somewhere around 5% for us. And so we can take 5% of that grant to cover our indirect costs, our administrative expenditures and overhead for helping to support that grant.
And while I really appreciate that we have opportunities, I do echo the words of the community member that spoke, that we really, that it would be really good of us to start trying to look for training opportunities that are either in-house, in-state, or online. I know that when we are individuals and we have budget concerns in our own households, we tend to not go out of state for trips. We'll do staycations. We will look to lower our own costs. And I would really appreciate for the district to start doing that with our own tax, with the community tax dollars as well. And she brought up very good points about, I remember last meeting, everybody here saying that we are closing schools to be fiscally responsible, but we do continue to approve these items that are out of state and for teachers to go. And I know last year they went to Florida, they went to other states. And I would really like to see us making some changes in what we are actually approving, regardless of what bucket of federal or state or MNO monies that we are looking at.
Ms. Case.
Thank you. Looking at the costs as they went through that, as I was reading again, $65 a night for a hotel is very inexpensive. And I think that's why it's held there, because of the cost of it. I have gone to enough further education programs to understand the value of meeting with other people who are in the same field that you are and sharing ideas to be able to do your job better. So I think it's important. We are in the business of education, and we need to continue to educate our employees on the best practices. Thank you.
Mrs. Baker.
And I just want to clarify, we did not send teachers to Florida. PVEA used dues money for teachers to go to Florida. The district did not send them. I just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you.
And it's not your turn to talk. Thank you.
So, Mrs. Berrigan, so the use of, so having indirect costs as a funding source, we would not be able to use monies in this bucket, so to speak, for MNO, would we?
I'm not sure I understand your question. We wouldn't
so
be able
if, to. Sorry, by using funds from this section, we're not having to dip into MNO. If
correct.
We were, but would we be able to apply these funds, I guess, in the opposite direction? Or are funds that are coming from indirect cost limited to how we can use them?
There are some limits to how indirect costs can be used. They're generally similar to the operational costs that are similar to an MNO purpose as well.
Okay, but by using these in the same way that we are able to use bond dollars and not have to use MNO, we can use these funds and not
correct.
Have to use MNO. Okay, thank you.
That's correct. And I would just say, if I may add, you know, Dr. Bales alluded to this, and I believe Mrs. Case did as well. We would not be able to find a hotel in the state for that rate. That's part of the reason why it's done. And it is just across the border there. So even with the travel costs, that is always something that I know that the ASBO organization keeps in mind for this conference, to keep the costs minimal. Unfortunately, some districts don't value PD for support staff as much. And so that's part of the intention behind that. And I appreciate hearing that there is support for professional development on the operational side of the work that we do.
Thank you. Does anybody else have any questions or comments? Seeing none, the motion's been made. Ms. Christensen?
Yeah, I just had one final comment. So I did work in private industry for many years. And when we sent staff out of town for training, we did train the trainer. There's 12 individuals on here. So I'm just making that point that in the future, it would be nice to maybe, if the training was only out of state, to send maybe one or two representatives, bring the data back and do that. While I do understand that it's nice to have these conversations, maybe bring it in-house, bring it in state, do it on at the PV. We have several buildings that we repurpose. We can get creative and start being fiscally responsible with our tax dollars.
Anybody else have any other comments, questions? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, please say nay.
Nay.
Any abstentions? Motion passes 4-1. Next on the agenda is call to the public, and I would ask that you turn your attention to the video monitors, please.
Call to the Public is about to convene. This portion of today's meeting allows the public the opportunity to address the Governing Board. Although state law does not require that the Governing Board hold a call to the public, the Paradise Valley Unified School District and its board have chosen to do so because we believe it's important to hear about concerns and issues from our community. While call to the public is not designed to be a discussion, the board is here to listen. Due to Arizona open meeting law, the governing board cannot respond to, discuss, or take any action on items brought up during this time. However, staff members may be directed to get back to you and address individual concerns. As a reminder, the point of this and every board meeting is to accomplish the business at hand, and to be able to do so in an open and collaborative way. All in attendance are expected to observe meeting rules, as well as rules of politeness and decorum, so that we may serve as an example to our students that issues can be discussed in a respectful and civil manner.
Thank you. Tonight we have one individual who has submitted a comment card prior to the start of the meeting, so she will have 3 minutes. And as a reminder, we ask that you please direct your comments to the board. So our only speaker tonight will be Laura Newitt.
I stand before you this evening with a heavy heart and a broken spirit. I am a mom of 3 children who have gone through the district, 2 that have graduated, and my last one currently an 8th grader at Vista Verde. My husband and I have attended the district as well, as I've always been proud to be part of it until recently. There has been a shift, a significant shift, and you have obviously felt it. I want to thank you for the February 8th board meeting and your vote to close Vista Verde. Thank you for causing fear and loss of hope, not only in the students, but in the staff. The staff are now stressed, worried, and contemplating their career choices, even leaving their profession. What is to become of my daughter's education for the next 3 months? Did you think of the consequences for closing the schools this year? That teachers would not stay for the remainder of the year, that they would begin their job search now. Quail Run is absorbing Sunset Canyon. Do you know how many openings there are at Quail Run? 2. What happens to the remaining staff? Of course, they're going to find employment elsewhere. Who could blame them? The consequences, though, students left feeling abandoned. Who watched out for the children of the closing schools? Who will make sure they are provided with a qualified teacher and prepare them for the next level? Were the teachers offered an incentive to stay? Did you even consider that? In the 3 short months it took you to decide to close the schools, in your eyes, it was a long 3 months, and you did your duty with your community committee and your many 2-hour meetings. In your eyes, the kids will be fine because it's only 3 short months till the school year is over. You are wrong. You all were the ones who were supposed to look out for the students. Thank you for creating an environment where our children are put in situations where they are bullied and taunted. Have you attended a festival sporting event? I'm guessing no. Rude chants of our school closing shouted at them from the crowd, including the school that is supposed to take them to be transferred to. Tony Patera said they are just buildings. Communities can be anywhere. While this statement has some truth, communities are not built overnight. It takes blood, sweat, and tears by students, parents, and staff. It doesn't happen in a day, a week, a month, or even a year. You want Vista Verde to become part of a community that has been bullying them for their school closing as if it was their choice. Please take your blinders off. I will tell you, a real community keeps fighting for which they know is even right after it's been taken away. They continue to stand by each other when they have been blindsided by what the future holds for them. It's amazing that in just 3 short months, the fate of hundreds was quickly so decided. A forum held at Vista Verde shared promises to teachers that everyone would have a place in the district. How is that even possible? If you get placed at a new school, they will give you new t-shirts. Are you serious? Do you think that was even anything they considered? Our superintendent, who has 1 foot out the door, made a comment that we must hold these meetings out of formality. If it were up to me, I wouldn't have them at all. This impression that there was a chance for voices to be heard and concerns that would be heavily considered vanished in that one line spoken. Thank you for finding a way to make middle school even harder, if it was not hard enough already. Adding uncertainty of, will my teacher be in class today? Will the club they sponsor be canceled? Thank you for taking away their stability in their lives. I know nothing that I say will matter tonight, but I regret sharing my thoughts with the board at least one last time, as I am hoping this has opened the community's eyes and votes will no longer be in your favor. Thank you.
Next on the agenda are items for discussion. Dr. Bales.
Thank you, President Greenberg, governing board members, cabinet, and guests. And tonight we present for first reading the committee's recommendation for the adoption of K-6 reading curriculum resources. Ms. Copen, would you please present?
Yes, good evening, President Greenberg, governing board, Dr. Bales, cabinet, and guests. Tonight's presentation is the first read for the K-6 English Language Arts adoption recommendations. Shelley Edgar, our elementary English Language Arts curriculum specialist and facilitator of this committee, is here this evening to present you the committee's process and recommendations and answer any questions that you may have.
All right, thank you, Ms. Copen. The purpose of this presentation is to share with the governing board a first reading of the process and recommendations of the K-6 English Language Arts Adoption Committee. Tonight, we will begin by acknowledging our committee members and the purpose of their work on this committee. Then I will present the timeline and process and highlight the work that was completed to make this recommendation. I will also share the evaluation criteria that was used to select the most effective product for Paradise Valley. We also had an opportunity to get teacher, principal, and community feedback, and we will highlight the insights we gathered from these stakeholders. Finally, we will end the presentation with a recommendation and next steps pending board approval. Before we begin our presentation, I would like to take a moment to introduce the dedicated individuals that served on this committee. In this group, we have representatives from various stakeholders, including parents, administrators, teachers, and an instructional coach and reading specialist, some of who are in the audience tonight. Every member on the committee brought their own individual experience and insights, providing us with a comprehensive evaluation of the reading and writing curriculum being considered. This process started in April of last school year and concluded a week ago. We truly appreciate this group and their work. Thank you to all of our members for their willingness to participate in this process. The purpose of this committee was to research K-6 comprehensive ELA curricula and make a recommendation for adopting the materials that best meet the needs of PV students and teachers. A comprehensive resource is one that includes evidence-based materials that build learning around phonological awareness, phonics, comprehension of literature and informational texts, vocabulary development, listening and speaking skills, spelling, grammar, handwriting, and writing. Before we begin, we wanted to address questions about why PV Schools is recommending the adoption of a new K-6 reading curriculum. PV Schools' contract with McGraw-Hill, the parent company for Wonders, has come to an end. We had a 6-year contract that was put into action during the 2017-2018 school year. We had an option within that contract to extend for a 7th optional year, and we took that option. This school year is our 7th extended year. Over the past 5 years, there has been a significant evolution in educational materials, particularly in the field of English language arts. More recently, our ELA materials have begun to align with the latest research on the science of reading, emphasizing a carefully structured approach of instruction, or carefully structured sequence of instruction. And as educators committed to providing the best possible support for our students, we recognize the importance of staying current with these advancements. By adopting a new reading curriculum that embraces the science of reading research and follows a systematic sequence of instruction, we ensure that our students receive the most effective and evidence-based approach to literacy development. Lastly, in response to the challenges presented by COVID-19, the pandemic, vendors have made significant strides in enhancing their reading curriculum offerings with technology solutions. These enhancements empower our teachers to more effectively address the diverse needs of their students through differentiated instruction. During this process, the committee was committed to incorporating a diverse range of stakeholder voices and perspectives. Recognizing that diverse input would enhance our recommendations, the committee diligently followed a structured process outlined in this table to engage stakeholders and adhere to open meeting laws. In March of 2023, we submitted a call to committee to PVEA, UPC, and PVP. Our committee was formed, and the stakeholders represented various grade levels, special education, English learners, title and non-title schools, and various programs including IB, Spanish immersion, and core knowledge. The committee met for almost a year, including homework over the summer, and the committee followed open meeting guidelines with agendas and notices posted physically and online at least 24 hours before the meeting, and meeting minutes were promptly posted online within 3 days of each meeting. Additionally, committee meetings are open to public attendance. Each meeting included dedicated time for community members to express their thoughts to the committee. This inclusive approach aimed to involve the broader community in the decision-making process. To reach out to the larger community, several events were planned this year. While the four final selected vendors have been on display in the lobby, we hosted open house nights where the lobby was open for extended hours on two different board meeting evenings and on an early release day. The final four vendors were also invited to present 45-minute presentations to teachers. Two lunch and learns were held, one for principals to view materials and ask questions and submit written input, and the other one for reading specialists. To ensure that all school communities had information and access to the materials, flyers were distributed to all schools and were posted throughout the campuses. These flyers contain digital access codes to each vendor's curriculum, as well as a link and a QR code to provide feedback for each vendor. The QR code made the information available with cell phones. Materials were on display in the lobby and accessible online for 60 days from November to February, and feedback forms were also available. Through these efforts, the committee received 162 pieces of feedback to consider from our community. The final steps of the committee work was to construct a recommendation for the governing board. We are hopeful to present the second read for approval on March 7th. This approval date will allow for materials to be ordered and provide training opportunities in the summer. We will present more about next steps at the end of the presentation. Committee members began this process by familiarizing themselves with the latest research in the field of reading instruction. Then they initiated the selection process by compiling initial vendor lists based on criteria such as Ed Reports, the Arizona Department of Education guidance, and the Every Student Succeeds Act, known as ESSA evidence. Following this, requests for proposals were sent to 13 selected vendors, resulting in 11 submissions. A link has been provided for the board in row 3 that lists the 13 initial vendors and the 11 companies that submitted their proposals. After reviewing the proposals, eight companies were asked to present to the committee. And through these vendor presentations, which were open to the public and recorded, each vendor had the opportunity to showcase their curriculum virtually. The committee meticulously assessed these presentations against the district's highest priorities and ultimately narrowed down the vendors to four. Subsequently, the committee developed and refined rubrics for evaluation purposes to ensure a fair and thorough assessment process. Additionally, they conducted a detailed review of district data, including student demographics, academic performance trends, and teacher experience. And finally, the committee engaged in rigorous research of each curriculum resource, carefully examining their components to make informed decisions about a potential adoption. Utilizing Hollis Scarborough's reading rope model and acknowledging the necessity of adhering to the scientific principles, our ELA adoption committee crafted evaluation criteria in the form of a rubric. This framework was instrumental in guiding their considerations and encompassing regulations concerning dyslexia for our state and the instructional practices that are taught to teachers through the K-5 literacy endorsement requirement from our state, and the Move On When Reading laws. The committee prioritized intervention components, the ease of implementation and training needs, which is a crucial aspect given that many of our PV teachers have had less than 5 years of teaching experience. Emphasizing early skills development to bolster Acadient scores and supporting the MTSS at tier one and intervention levels were also central to their deliberations. The ELA Adoption Committee narrowed down the pool of submissions from 8 to 4 finalists, employing evaluation criteria established by the committee. Articles about the science of reading and the importance of building content knowledge through reading assisted each member in identifying their top components for a new reading curriculum. The list above indicates 7 components that the committee identified as being the most important. The 8 vendors presented virtual presentation, and the committee evaluated the material using the lens of the 7 components above. Through this process, the committee narrowed the list to the 4 finalists. The committee identified the following 4 standout contenders listed in alphabetical order: Benchmark Advance, Great Minds, Wit and Wisdom paired with Really Great Reading, Houghton Mifflin Harcourt Into Reading, and Savvis, My View, paired with StudySync for 6th grade. These finalists were selected based on their alignment with the committee standards and priorities, demonstrating exceptional potential to meet the diverse needs of the district and facilitate effective reading instruction. The committee then constructed a comprehensive rubric assigning ratings ranging from 0 to 2 based on this series of critical indicators. These indicators encompass various facets of curriculum effectiveness, including quality literature, foundational skills in grades K-3, word study for grades 4 through 6, adherence to the Arizona ELA standards, content knowledge and comprehension, other academic areas such as grammar and vocabulary, differentiation, English language learner resources, special education alignment and resources, writing, organization and layout, assessments, as well as technology and digital platform integration. In crafting the rubric, the committee closely considered additional reputable resources such as the Reading League and Ed Reports. These resources provided valuable insights and benchmarks to further refine the evaluation criteria. The committee integrated findings and recommendations from these sources into the rubric, ensuring a comprehensive assessment that encompassed best practices and evidence-based approaches to literacy instruction. After studying each curriculum, considering community feedback and administrator input, the committee narrowed the choice to Into Reading by Houghton Mifflin Harcourt and Really Great Reading paired with Wit and Wisdom by Great Minds. Both of these resources would provide a solid reading curriculum for our district. In fact, our committee had a very difficult time coming to consensus. After voting, a slight majority of 54% voted for Really Great Reading paired with Wit and Wisdom. We then asked the elementary principals to indicate which curriculum would best serve their teachers and students. 75% of the administrators indicated that they preferred Really Great Reading paired with Wit and Wisdom, with a strong consideration that Really Great Reading was part of this choice, many saying that their staff had invested 3 years into developing successful routines using really great reading and that they are seeing progress. Finally, I reviewed each choice with our reading specialists, and this group was also split in their choices. The cabinet reviewed all of the input and agreed that the majority of the committee that really great reading paired with wit and wisdom would be the best choice for our district reading curriculum. Several factors contributed to this decision. First, there was a considerable price difference between the two vendors. Wit and Wisdom, paired with Really Great Reading, submitted a best and final offer at $3.9 million for a 7-year contract. And HMH InterReading submitted a best and final offer at $5.4 million for a 7-year contract. We wanted to note that this adoption is funded through District Additional Assistance Override Funds, which is earmarked to support curriculum adoptions and technology. And we thank our voters for making this adoption possible. All throughout this process, many of our teachers and administrators have communicated their support for maintaining Really Great Reading curriculum for phonics instruction. Really Great Reading was initially implemented within our Title I schools in the spring of 2020. This resource replaced the phonics instruction within Wonders and was in response to our Title I schools showing very little progress in Acadian's data for early reading. Most non-Title I campuses leveraged their ESSER funding to implement Really Great Reading into their K-3 curriculum too. Teachers have now been using Really Great Reading for about 2 to 3 years. There was very high advocacy for keeping this in place. As explained earlier, the community expressed their insights during the 60-day materials review window, and review of this feedback validated that many of our stakeholders were interested in continuing with Really Great Reading, and many also commented that Wit and Wisdom had high rigor and approaches literacy instruction in a unique and challenging way. The committee reviewed state ASA reading scores for the past 5 years, and our scores have remained stagnant, with about 50% of our students being able to score proficient or highly proficient. Wit and Wisdom routines bring classroom strategies with proven high effect sizes. Strategies such as the Socratic seminars, high-level questioning, anchor charts, and writing models. Wit and Wisdom uses authentic literature, and many titles are Caldecott and Newbery Award winners. In addition, Wit and Wisdom is structured into quarterly modules, which is similar in organization to StudySync, our 712 English language arts curriculum. Really Great Reading is focused on preventing and remediating decoding weaknesses in students in all grades in K-3 using reading instruction that is research-based, interactive, explicit, structured, and multisensory. Really Great Reading can also be used with fourth to sixth graders, students that need to assist in closing phonics gaps. To bridge the learning between decoding, which is learning how to read, and reading text to deepen comprehension, there are high-level decodable readers for kindergarten through second grade called geodes that come with this adoption. These books are 80% decodable and match the content topics being learned in Wit and Wisdom, so they help build knowledge while simultaneously providing beginning readers additional decoding practice. Using Wit and Wisdom, a teacher will facilitate students' learning through collaboration and independent work. A strength of Wit and Wisdom is that the curriculum builds rich content knowledge in several areas, including the arts and sciences. Science of reading research indicates that the more students learn about content, the more background knowledge they build, which leads to increased comprehension for all readers. Wit and Wisdom also uses complex texts that lift the level of rigor. To meet this higher level of comprehension, teachers will scaffold instruction by using anchor charts, Socratic seminars, and levels of questioning. In addition, grammar and writing are integrated into each story and module. These two companies each specialize in their own areas of expertise, but have merged to create a comprehensive curriculum. In light of all that has been presented, the recommendation to the governing board is to adopt Really Great Reading paired with Great Minds, Wit and Wisdom for the K-6 English Language Arts core curriculum for a period of 7 years. Pending the approval of this curriculum by the governing board, several important next steps need to be considered. If approved, really great reading paired with great minds, wit and wisdom, will be the required core curriculum for all K-6 classrooms. A detailed plan for implementing the new curriculum is being created, including timelines, training sessions for teachers and staffs, and communication strategies to inform stakeholders about the changes. In December, the K-6 teachers received a save the date for summer reading training, and we are also planning training with instructional coaches, reading specialists, and principals to start building capacity to for campus support. Providing ongoing professional development opportunities to ensure that teachers are well equipped to effectively implement the new curriculum. This may include workshops, coaching, and access to the resources and support materials. We will work to create a plan to efficiently allocate the resources, such as textbooks and supplementary materials, and we will ensure that classrooms have the necessary resources to facilitate the instruction and learning. I will facilitate work teams to create GVC documents that will serve as a guide for implementation. Lastly, we will establish processes for assessing and monitoring the implementation of the new curriculum to ensure that it is meeting the intended goals and objectives. This may involve conducting regular assessments, collecting feedback from teachers and students, and making adjustments as needed. We appreciate your attention to this presentation. The second reading for this adoption is scheduled for March 7th, 2024, and we're happy to address any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Ms. Edgar. That was incredibly complete. Does any member of the board have any questions or comments? Mrs. Case?
Thank you. This subject is near and dear to my heart. So I have a question. I can't remember names of programs so much. Is the really great reading the class I took, Dr. Corson? I mean, I went in when the teachers were being trained. It's the same one?
Yes, Ms. Case, it is.
Okay. Okay. I couldn't remember the name of the program. I really like that. I did make a suggestion to Dr. Corson when he was in a different capacity that he include the second grade material to first grade, so they would have the opportunity to learn the sounds at an earlier age. How will that be affected with this adoption?
You want me off? Well, we already did what you had suggested. So we put the student kits from the second and third grade program called HD Word. We put one of those in every kindergarten and first grade classroom at the time that had really great reading, because several schools purchased it at different times with ESSER funds, but when Dr. Corson and I met, we already implemented that. So they do have access to the second grade materials.
Okay, that's fabulous. And what is the ratio of the materials per students? Because there were magnets, there were manipulatives. It used to be one kit per two people. How does that work?
Yeah, it still is one per two students. Several of our Title I schools during COVID-19 pandemic purchased one-to-one. So there may be schools that have additional that they purchase with their own funding, but the program comes one kit for every two students.
And so some might have extra going forward. Do you know the idea of continuing what's working? Yes, thank you so much. And this program is really a good program. I mean, it covers all the sounds, and I've gone through the program very carefully, and I appreciate that. And thank you for moving that down. So there's children who need to know an IGH sound in first grade so they can read the word right. But anyway, I appreciate that. And I've been, what materials were out there? Was it when you got down to four different, or was it two?
Well, we had all four materials out
there.
Yes. And then when the committee met their final night, we narrowed it down to two, and then we continued to narrow from there.
Okay. So were there ever just the two materials in the lobby?
Not just two, but they were included in all four.
All four.
Yeah.
Okay. And then my other question is, what kind of online material and how is it utilized in this program?
So there's a teacher portal that they go into and they can access materials. They can also access different grade level materials if they need something that's a little bit more challenging or easier. And then there's also ways to assign students materials.
I'm curious, is there any kind of an oral presentation of the little sounds that they have? Is there some kind of a way that they can look at OR and hear the sound back or anything of that nature?
So for really great reading, they also have another portal where the teachers display like a video that teaches the sounds, and the students have practice activities that they do. They do pronounce some of the sounds depending on the activity. Sometimes they will pronounce the sound and the student has to choose the right answer. And then all of that feedback goes back to the teacher so they can see what the student needs additional help with.
Okay. So there's interactive type of activities, because I have found that children really like that interactive type of thing. When I recently visited Fireside with Mrs. Baker, that kindergarten teacher was presenting the sounds that you give to second graders, and it was so exciting to see kindergarten students utilizing them. And it's, we don't give our kids enough credit for what they can learn at an earlier age and how they take it in. And so we always have to be having them reach for, and then making sure they're learning it, but reaching for higher things also. So thank you. This sounds really good. And I appreciate the laborious time spent by this committee going through many, many, many sets of materials. So thank you. And I'm so glad you're keeping that program. Thank you.
Mr. Pantera.
Yes, thank you. I do also appreciate all the work and the time and the great way you've presented it here today. Just a couple of questions. I do like integrated programs like this. Mm-hmm. Some of these programs, sometimes they'll focus on one, say phonics, or just on word recognition at the exclusion of the others. But this seems like, I love this integration of everything that's roped together. I like that. When you talked about evaluation criteria, I heard you mention special education alignment and resources, ELL. I didn't hear you talk about the gifted alignment, because they have their own things, but how does it align with that?
So they don't have a separate gifted alignment, but we have had Karen Brown, our gifted director, look at the materials, and she was very pleased with the materials and thought that they really had high levels of rigor. We've also heard that our cluster model teachers that teach students in younger grades are identified as gifted, that they also really thought that Wit and Wisdom had some really high level of rigor for them.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody else have any?
I have another question, if I may.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
I had put it in my notes, but I didn't look at them because I got so excited. How is spelling used in this? Does spelling come from really great reading, or how do they integrate spelling? And do they build on spelling rules from year to year, utilizing the same program? That's very important.
So the K-3 has a spelling component. There's not a spelling.
In which program?
Really great reading.
Okay.
And the students are not given a spelling list, but they're taught the spelling pattern and the spelling rule. And then they are given a spelling test based on words that follow that pattern. So there's not a study list. They're supposed to learn the pattern that's been given. And so then Wit and Wisdom picks up in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade with giving, they don't have a necessary spelling test, but they teach morphology. And they teach like Greek and Latin roots and how those words expand.
What was that word they teach? What? What was that word?
Called morphology.
Morphology. Mm-hmm. Okay. And what is that geo word you used?
So geodes is the name of the decodable readers that help bridge really great reading, the decoding practice, with reading about content. So they're high quality decodable readers that match the content of the stories that they're learning in the Wit and Wisdom program. So it's kind of a bridge between both programs.
Okay, thank you.
Does anybody else have any questions, comments? Mrs. Baker?
Your presentation was so thorough that it answered my questions, but I just want to say thank you, and I really appreciate all the hard work that went into this and the presentation.
Thank you.
Mrs. Christensen?
Yes, agreed. I echo everybody's statements. Wow, what a thorough presentation. So lots of pluses here. I do want to say that doing things like this in our district is how we get our students back. When we put the dollars directly into the classroom to support an increase in academic achievement, I love that. And we need to do more of this. And I just want to thank you and the team for year-long dedication on going through this process. This is not easy to be on these committees, and so we really appreciate all the thorough analysis and the fact that you followed open meeting law, you made it open to the public, the amazing thorough analysis, and you said 162 pieces of feedback from the community. Phenomenal. So my questions are, you indicated that it's going to be required curriculum for all, is it K through six?
Yes.
The first question is, how will the teachers be given extra time to learn how to teach this? And is that going to be a summer thing? Will there be instructional time? Or we haven't fully implemented PLCs yet. So how will that work?
So we do have some training planned for early June and some other additional training for the summer. We haven't fully developed anything yet since it hasn't been board approved. So we're kind of talking through those ideas. But then we also anticipate we'll always have new teachers starting, you know, right at the start of the school year. They would have missed that opportunity. So we'll have some training days once school starts too for new teachers.
Great. So as I tour some, and I haven't toured in a while, but when I tour schools, it seems like there's bits and pieces of different learning types, different learning modules, et cetera, in all the different schools. How are we going to enforce, ensuring that everybody goes onto this curriculum? Or is there incentives, or how do we enforce that?
So many teachers are really excited about a new curriculum. They've been thinking about it for the last couple of years. So I think there's a lot of excitement that's going to come with that new piece. We will pick up the Old Wonders program. We have a partnership with a company that will buy back those books or perhaps donate them if they cannot buy them back. So that helps with having different pieces of curriculum out there. So we'll be collecting the old curriculum and then giving out the new curriculum.
Mm-hmm. And finally, my final comment is when you started presenting, you were talking about new and new this, and I was thinking, we're going to be pushing it all online. So I'm really happy to hear that it's not all online, and there's a combination of different learning techniques, and I was really excited to see Mrs. Case's excitement, because I know phonics is her thing. So when you said new, I thought, we're going to get away from phonics, but that's wonderful, and I know Mrs. Case was really happy about that too. So thank you. Thank you so much for your presentation.
You're welcome.
Thank you. It really was that complete. I don't have any questions in particular. I do want to echo what Mr. Pantera said. I appreciate the integration of so many pieces. It feels like education swings back and forth all the time between separating things out and then putting them back together. And I feel like we always do better when we're integrating and realizing that, you know, we're not just teaching a whole child, but we're teaching a whole curriculum. And so I appreciate that there's so much of that integrated into this curriculum adoption. And I just thank you. I mean, this really was the most thorough presentation we've had on curriculum in quite some time.
Thank you.
With that, this is first read, and we look forward to seeing you back next meeting.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So next on the agenda is a call for executive session. Tonight we have a call for two executive sessions pursuant to ARS 3843103A1. The governing board may vote to hold an executive session The purpose is to review and discuss contract terms for employment of the interim superintendent, and pursuant to ARS 38431-0385, we may vote to hold an executive session regarding negotiations with employee groups. The purpose is to meet for instruction and direction. Mr. Pantera, may I have a single, very complete motion for the two executive sessions, please?
Yes, you may. I move that the governing board convene an executive session pursuant to Arizona Revised Statutes 38-431.03A1, which reads as follows. Discussion or consideration of employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, demotion, dismissal, salaries, disciplining or resignation of a public officer, appointee, or employee of any public body, except that, with the exception of salary discussions, an officer, appointee, or employee may demand that the discussion or consideration occur at a public meeting. The public body shall provide the officer, appointee, or employee with written notice of the executive session as is appropriate, but not less than 24 hours for the officer, appointee, or employee to determine whether the discussion or consideration should occur at a public meeting. The purpose is to review and discuss contract terms for employment of the interim superintendent, and move the governing board call for executive session in accordance with Arizona Revised Statutes 38-431.03A5, discussions or consultations with designated representatives of the public body in order to consider its position and instruct its representatives regarding negotiations with employee organizations regarding the salaries, salary schedules, or compensation paid in the form of fringe benefits of employees of the public body. The purpose is to meet for instructions and/or direction.
Thank you. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed, please say nay. Any abstentions? Motion passes unanimously. Our regular meeting is recessed at 8:07 to go into executive session, and we'll reconvene after we return from executive session. There will be no action taken in the executive session for agenda item J1 or J2. There will be no action taken after the regular meeting reconvenes for agenda item J1. There may be possible action when the regular meeting reconvenes for agenda item J2. Thank you. We good? Okay, we are reconvening a regular meeting. Mr. Pantera, may I have a motion?
I move the governing board provide direction to administration regarding negotiations with employee groups pursuant to discussion in executive session.
Thank you. No discussion. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, say nay. Any abstentions? The motion passes unanimously. I'd like to say that we reconvened at 10:10. Sorry, I didn't have my glasses on. Before we adjourn, I would like to remind you that the next regular board meeting will be held on Thursday, March 7, 2024 at 6:30 p.m. Mr. Pantera, may I have a motion to adjourn?
I move we adjourn.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed, say nay. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you.